A motion sensor, an ESP32 dev board, Home Assistant, the time of day of the week, and finally, the sun. Today, I'm going to use all these things to show you how you can never touch a light switch in your house ever again. Let's get started. Today, specifically, I'm talking about the four different light sources in my office. The key light that's shining on my face right now, the overhead light in the ceiling lamp, the light strip that backlights the desk behind me, and finally, the light bars that you can see, well, you can't really see, on my left and right. So all these lights are smart and can be controlled with Home Assistant, so that'll be my main hub for all of this automation. Here is what I want to accomplish. One, these lights should be motion activated. They should come on when I enter the room and they should turn off when I leave. Two, certain lights only need to be on certain times of the day and certain days of the week. For example, this key light, it just doesn't need to be on when I'm not working or when I'm not recording one of these videos. Three, some of these lights can change color, and there are certain times when bright lights are obviously not the best. I think if I can make them a different color before bedtime, it'll help to not keep my brain awake. And finally, all these lights have brightness controls. The brightness should really be dependent on how bright it is outside. When it's dark out, they don't need to be as bright. When it's really bright outside, they need to brighten up so you can see them in comparison to the light coming through the windows. Now, I didn't expect this when I started, but getting the motion detection working was actually the easy part. For this, I bought a motion sensor breakout board and an ESP32 dev board. All you really have to do is provide power through the USB to the ESP32, then run three wires from the motion board to the ESP32. One is the hot wire, one is the ground, and the other is the signal. Just connect the signal to one of the GPIO pins on the ESP32, take note of what pin you used, and then the ground goes to the ground and the hot wire goes to the 3V3 pin on the ESP32. Now, to get this sensor to control my lights, I'm going to be using Home Assistant with a program called ESP Home. ESP Home allows you to connect a ton of different types of accessories to an ESP32 and then instantly control them or monitor them with Home Assistant. Getting ESP Home set up is pretty simple. All you really have to do is provide the configuration for the ESP32, then flash the chip with ESP Home. Make sure when you're doing this that you press and hold the boot button on the ESP32 the first time you set up ESP Home so it can detect the board and complete the installation. I'm going to put the configuration file up on GitHub and link it in the description so you can use it as an example if you want to do this yourself. I'll also make a more detailed video on setting up ESP Home if you're interested. So if you want to see that, go ahead and get subscribed to the channel and it'll be coming out soon. After setting up the hardware, the motion sensor appears in Home Assistant, and it's super easy to make an automation that'll turn on any number of lights when motion is detected. The rest of this whole automation is handled in Home Assistant, and making this work correctly actually took quite a bit of code. So in order to accomplish this, I used four different features of Home Assistant. One of them was light templates, the other one is Jinja2 macros, the third one is helper entities, and finally the fourth one is automations. The best way to explain this is from the outside in, and since the automation is the outermost layer, let's take a look at how that works first. So any automation you set up in Home Assistant has three parts. One is the trigger, the second is the conditions, and the third is the actions. The trigger is really simple. It's just essentially the motion sensor, and whenever that switches to a detected state, the trigger is triggered. The condition section is designed to be a kind of an extra sanity check after the trigger. In my case, I created an additional helper switch that acts as a manual override. If the manual override switch is not enabled, the automation will move into the action section. And this is where things start to get a little more complicated. So the action is a loop, and this loop runs until the motion sensor changes to the state of clear, which means there is no more motion. The loop itself evaluates six different conditions. Each of these conditions have to do with the time of the day and the day of the week. As you can see, the configuration is just controlled at a very coarse level, what lights are on at what times of day. The other thing that it does is it makes sure this key light doesn't come on during the weekend when it would normally be on during the week. Each of the time frames really just tells the system to turn on certain lights and turn other ones off. It's important to note that you should never assume that a light is in a specific state, and that's why I specifically turn on the lights I want and turn off the ones I don't, even if that light was already off in a previous time frame. Now, there's a couple things to note here, and we'll get into those as I go deeper into the layers. The first is the name of the lights. You'll notice that they're called clone lights. The next one is the brightness. In most of these conditions, the brightness is set to 1. And this is really just some hackery I put together to get the light to automatically adjust to the outdoor illuminance. Now, the final simple part of this action is to delay for 5 minutes. This just makes it so the loop doesn't just continuously burn CPU. It runs every 5 minutes, and that's plenty of time to make the small adjustments to the lights as the day progresses. So before I leave this section, I should also note that you can edit all of this as YAML instead of having to use the UI. I'm going to grab this YAML as it sits and put it on GitHub so you can take a look at it, and the link will be in the description. Okay, so let's go one layer deeper, and that's these clone lights. So there's a couple problems with these lights. Since they're all made by different manufacturers, and as a matter of fact, these pole lights weren't even smart until I hacked them up myself. Video coming on that soon, by the way. Brightness on these lights is kind of all over the place. 100% brightness on one light might be crazy bright, while on others it's an acceptable value. And it's the same with the minimum brightness. Some get to an acceptable low level around 10%, and others will be like totally kind of off when they're at like 40%. So I can't really keep it that way. To fix that, and to allow for the lights to be controlled by the outdoor luminance, I have to essentially calculate brightness and then give a different brightness level to the light after doing the calculations. And these clone lights allow me to do just that. So in the main configuration file of Home Assistant, I use a feature called a template that allows me to make fake entities. These entities offer a ton of capabilities, but what I'm using them for is to clone my real lights, but inject a calculation into the brightness section. So as you can see here, there's an entry in the YAML file for each of the clones, and they're all mostly the same, so I'm just gonna look at one of them. The Home Assistant docs explain how this all works, and again, I'll share the file and the link in the description. Anyways, each template has 4 template underscore entries that tells the system how to get values to display to the user in the UI. It's just getting the value from the real light in all these cases, except for the brightness. For the brightness, it's getting the value from a helper that I created, and I'll cover the helper next. Below that, there's 4 more entries in the YAML for turning on the light, turning off the light, adjusting the brightness, and adjusting the color. Again, for all of these, I'm just piping the value over from the real light entity. But for brightness, I'm doing a calculation using a Jinja2 macro, which is really just a function that'll help you to not have to paste the code a bunch of times. And as you can see, I'm calling this function called getBrightness, and I'm passing it the ID of the real light, as well as the brightness value that was provided to the clone light. So let's jump into that macro and see how it works. The top part of this macro is really just some definitions. This is where I define the relative brightness, as I've been calling it, for these lights. This allows me to set what I think is correct for maximum and minimum brightness and make them so they all kind of act the same at these levels. I've been messing with this over a little bit, and I'll probably continue to tweak it a little while, but I'm pretty happy with it. The next part is the actual function, and this is where the outdoor luminance comes in. I added an illuminance sensor that I found on GitHub. This is a software-based illuminance sensor. It's not like I have a sensor outside. Essentially, this plugin uses weather data and sunrise and sunset data to estimate outdoor luminance. Here's the chart of the last week for my house. It's pretty accurate, and for my use cases, it works perfectly. So this macro that I created does the following things. One, and this is my hack from above, if the brightness is set to 1 on the clone, the system will use the auto brightness feature. If it's not 1, it'll just set the brightness according to my relative brightness level. 2, if we're in this auto brightness mode from above, we're gonna set a maximum and minimum illuminance level. And really what that means is that this illuminance level ranges quite a bit, and honestly, I've never seen the thing hit the max, so I don't really want to set my maximum to be like when it's the brightest day in the brightest part of the world. So I've set a relative value. We have a minimum and maximum, which is kind of sane for like this is bright and this is dark. So if we're between that minimum and maximum though, we're going to figure out the percentage level of the outdoor luminance. Then we're going to set the lights to that percentage of the relative brightness. I know there's a lot of math and weird calculations in there. It's a percentage of a percentage, but it actually works really well. Finally, we're going to return that brightness number to the real light, and the light will adjust its brightness. Okay, so that's the macro, but let me just cover one that I skipped over, and that's the helper I mentioned earlier. To store the brightness setting and not forget it, we need to place it somewhere. Helpers are a standard feature in Home Assistant that allow you to essentially create stateful variables. I created one for each of the light's brightness levels, and that's really all there is about that. Okay, so like 2 minutes for you and like a week for me, you finally put that all together and this is what you get. The lights come on when I walk in, they turn off when I leave, the right ones are on, and when I want the brightness, it's always right where I want it, no matter how bright or dark it is outside. Thanks for sticking around all the way to the end. If you like the video and you want to see more like this, just hit the like button and get subscribed. And until next time, happy coding.